मुंद्रा जी, आई हैव अनम्यूटेड यू। अलाउ मी अ मोमेंट प्लीज। जस्ट अ सेकंड, आई एम मेकिंग द कोहोर्ट
या
एज़ वेल, सो दैट या
थैंक यू।
सो यू कैन अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ।
यस, गुड इवनिंग महेंद्र जी, गुड इवनिंग मालू जी, गुड इवनिंग अतुल जी। व्हाट टाइम वी स्टार्ट मालू जी? 5:05।
Hi all, thank you so much for joining. It's 5 p.m. and I'd request Mundra ji to please welcome the gathering.
Good evening friends, I am Ghanshyam Mundra, coordinator of this webinar. It's really a matter of great pleasure for me to welcome you all. I welcome Atul ji Lahoti, chairman of MVPM. I welcome Sri V.K. Malo ji, chairman of scholar committee. I welcome all the office bearer of MVPM and scholar committee participating in this webinar. I welcome all the three young speakers of the evening, Priya Somani, Rahul Laddha, and Radhika Sada Bisani. I welcome our young moderator, young and dynamic moderator, Mr. Vinay Mantri. For the benefit of all, for the benefit of those who are participating in the MVPM webinar for the first time, I'll give a brief introduction of MVPM. Mahesuri Vidya Pracharak Mandal, a young non-profit, non-political charitable organization, is devoted to the cause of education. 9 decades back, Mahesuri Vidya Pracharak Mandal started a hostel in Pune, and today it has graduated to run several scholarship scheme, skill development center, colleges, school, hostels. These are spread across Mumbai, Pune, Ahmednagar, Solapur, and other places. In 2012, MVPM instituted a scholar award for academic excellence in advanced studies. Since then, exceptional scholars from reputed institutes like IIT, BITS Pilani, IIM, Yale Universities, Cambridge Universities, London School of Economics, as well as PhD, Chartered Accountants, Medical Practitioners, IAS, IRS, IPS, etc. have been our awardees. The awardees are selected through a rigorous selection process, independently carried out by eminent jury member. Our scholar awardees have established themselves very well in their areas of excellence. In collaboration with our 100 plus strength of awardees, time and again, we conduct webinar on spreading awareness on important current issues. Our previous webinars on hosted speakers such as eminent investors Mr. Anand Rathi, Mr. Mahendra Jaju, famous vaccinologist Dr. Hemant Patel, Dr. Akanksha Rathi Maheshwari, etc. Before I hand over the proceedings to Mr. Vinay Mantri, moderator, coach, and keynote speaker of today's webinar, it is my pleasure to introduce him. Mr. Vinay Mantri is behavioral coach on the topics of life, relationship, and communication. Mr. Vinay has coached and facilitated workshops for over 750 participants from Deloitte, Sterling and Wilson, Asian Paints, and ITC, to name a few. Passionate and witty, his motivations lie in helping people to lead a better life. Articulate simply, he wishes to create an impact on a larger audience through the resources of his website, personal coaching, and interacting with mass audiences. Now I request Mr. Vinay Mantri to please take this webinar forward. Mr. Vinay Mantri, thank you.
Thank you so much, Mundra ji, for your warm welcome. And hi all, I would like to acknowledge the presence of Atul Bhav, Rajendra ji, Mahendra ji, and all other dignitaries of MVPM. Today, beginning the fourth webinar of this 4-weekend series. We are really excited to start off and kick off in a very positive way with our 3 dynamic speakers. Let's quickly get to their introduction. Speaker 1, Radhika Sarda Besani. Radhika Sarda Besani is a business strategist who currently leads business management and P&L for portfolio of residential projects at Godrej Properties. She has worked across the real estate value chain in multiple roles through her tenure, including land acquisitions. Radhika is a chartered accountant and has completed her MBA from Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar, with gold medals for academics and for best all-rounder. With that, I'd like to welcome Radhika. I'm unmuting you. Please stay unmuted. Let me know if you can speak.
Thank you so much, Vinay, for the introduction. I have a CA background, basically. My father is a chartered accountant, surveyor, insurance surveyor, and loss assessor. So that's how I chose to do my CA journey. I did my CA in 2013, and May 13 attempt, and I started preparing for CAT for October 13, hoping that nothing goes wrong with the result. And so immediately after CAT, then exam B happened. And I would say those 2 years have been an incredible journey. Probably the number of hours spent inside or the activities we did inside were way, way more than probably 3 or 4 years outside. So during my MBA, I did my internship with Godrej Properties Limited. And so with my internship, I got a PPO. I could win the best project award from a batch of 50 interns across the top B schools. And then after that, it has been 4 years with Godrej Properties now. I started as a management trainee, and as being a management trainee, I could take over a lot of projects, mostly in the sales and marketing approval domain. And then I started over my business development, which in real estate parlance essentially means acquisition of lands. So I did that in Pune as well as Bangalore. And then I moved to a corporate strategy role. And after that, it's been my current role, which is basically leading the P&L for a portfolio of residential projects. So currently, I handle close to 2 million square feet of residential projects in Bangalore. And I'm responsible for its bottom line, so meaning I look after the sales, construction, everything. So that has been a journey so far, and I hope and look forward to continuing the business role.
Thank you so much, Radhika. With that, I'd also like to introduce our next speaker for the evening, Shreya Somani. Shreya is a chartered accountant and I just spotlight her so that everyone can see who we're talking about. Yes. So Shreya is a chartered accountant and a company secretary with an All India rank 2. She's currently in the second year of her MBA journey with SP Jain Institute of Management and Research. Prior to MBA, she's worked with Deutsche Bank in the investment banking division and with BDO Haribhakti in Risk Advisory Services. Yes, Riya, would you like to share your journey with us?
Hey, hi, Vinay. Thank you so much. And hi, all. Pleasure to see you all. So talking about my journey, I completed my CA attempt was in November 15. And I have done my articleship with BDO Haribhakti. So post my CA clearing, I continued as a consultant with BDO Haribhakti in the risk advisory services domain. So I was looking after forensic audits or internal audits and likewise. And then afterwards, going forward with risk advisory, after that, I realized that, you know, I want to see my fit, whether I am fit for investment banking, because, you know, that time there was a craze in the market that, you know, everyone wants to be in the investment banking division. So I got an opportunity with Deutsche Bank, and I was in the middle office investment banking division, where we used to support the London directors and traders, basically looking after the London market. MBA had always been on my cards, and so I, after the Deutsche Bank stint, I addressed to my calling of MBA, and I gave my CAT, and I got selected in SP Jain Institute of Management and Research, that is in Mumbai, and currently I'm in my second year of MBA, and on current basis, due to the pandemic, I am doing, you know, the past few months have been virtual MBA for me. And currently I'm doing my autumn's internship as well. So this is pretty much my journey till MBA, till now.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Next, I'd like to invite Rahul Ladda, and I'd be giving his brief profile. Rahul Ladda is a chartered accountant and has done his MBA from IMA in 2018. He's currently working with CK Birla Group in strategy roles covering strategic planning, investment analysis, and financial planning and analysis. Rahul is a CA final, All India Rank 10, topper of ICAI Central Region, which covers the 7 states. And Rahul has also bagged an All India Rank 49 in IPCC. Rahul, please share your journey with us. Over to you.
First off, a very good afternoon to everyone. And thanks, MFPM, for having me here. I hope that I'll be able to add valuable discussion and help the audience clarify that out. Right? Okay, about my journey. So I know it sounds a bit cliche, but CA just happened to me, honestly. I took commerce post then 10th, and I didn't know really what should I do. Or hamesha yahi sikha tha ki commerce ke baad mein CA hi ek decent course hai, otherwise there's nothing. And my friends were doing CA, peers were also pursuing this course, so I thought that I'll also have to do this. So that is why I boarded the journey. A rank in IPCC actually helped me to get an internship or articleship in PwC. And during those 3 years that I spent there doing the statutory audit, I realized that I do not enjoy what I do. And I cannot see myself for the rest of my life doing this. And the another enlightened fact that enlightened me was that I didn't enjoy this because I was at the bottom of the pyramid of the corporate ladder and ended up doing all the clerical role. But I also did not like what my seniors were doing. And this fact was the one that lit up the light and said, you know, since you do not enjoy what your seniors are doing, even if you grow in this, you wouldn't enjoy the work. So that time I made myself very clear that I need to switch. And that was before even completing CA. Nevertheless, I tried to give it the best shot, which landed up securing ranking finals as well. But straight away after doing CA, I thought of pursuing MBA because of the two reasons. First, that I wasn't sure that I want to establish myself in finance. I wanted to study the other management and business disciplines to make a choice of my career. And then second, that while CA offers an incredible course and curriculum to set up a strong foundation on finance, but there are certain skills that are missed in the course. So the leadership skills, people management, project management, negotiation skills, communication skills, all of those were missed kind of in CA, and that I thought that I'll do MBA. Fortunately, CAT happened and I got selected in IIM Ahmedabad. The 2 years journey that I had spent there was incredible. I completed my post-graduation in 2018, post which I was placed with CK Birla Group. The group had a management training program wherein we had to work for 6 months as two stints of 6 months each in two of their group companies. So my first stint was with the corporate office wherein I was working with the group CFO. And the second stint was with one of the flagship company called NBC in Jaipur, wherein I was working under the CEO. Post the stints got over, I was absorbed by NBC and worked as an executive assistant to CA. So what does that mean? Purane time mein jaise rajaon ke salahkar hote the, jo unko batate the ki kya karna chahiye, so it's kind of that role. Wherein there are like certain strategic projects that the CEO has. So you are responsible for driving those projects, collaborating with the people around, identifying roadblocks and identifying solutions as well. That got over. And there were certain other roles as well, other things, for example, representing the company to the chairman in annual appraisals and budget approvals. Once that got over, just 10 days back, I got shifted to another role, which is financial and investment planning. So this team basically does all the investments that would flow into the company. So anyone, any company or any department or subsidiary company want to make any investment, this would pass through this team and then only this will crystallize. So yeah, that is what I'm doing as of now.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Yes. So Rahul, I believe you've been an IMA graduate, and thank you so much for sharing that with us. Were you really sure where you wanted to go when you had options like IIM Ahmedabad and IIM Calcutta in your kitty?
Yeah, so basically I converted to institutes, IIM Ahmedabad and IIM Calcutta among others. Ahmedabad. So the option, the choice was really among these two. And Calcutta is basic, is actually for people who want to establish themselves in finance, because that is a there are so many firms that visit Calcutta and they do not visit any other campus. But I wasn't really sure that I want to make my career in finance. I rather wanted to study all the discipline first and then make a choice where I want to go. And that is why IIM Ahmedabad was an obvious choice for me.
Okay. And I believe it has been working great for you as well.
Yes.
Completely. Yes. We also have Radhika with us, and we'll move to Radhika. Radhika, you've evolved through a couple of roles, land acquisition, strategy, P&L. So did your CA plus MBA skills help you in any way? Could you please throw some light on that?
Yes, Vinay. So definitely I would say across different profiles that I have been able to work, the CA as well as MBA skill set has come very handy for me. So if I have to give you some examples, when I did my internship, so my internship was in the operations domain in real estate, and the project was reducing the cost of construction. So given that I have no architectural or in civil engineering or engineering background, my first day at the site was like, I didn't even know the difference between cement and concrete. So I was like that blank. But MBA had given me a life skill, which was Jugaad. So obviously, I mean, we have been giving presentations we have no idea about. But that is exactly, obviously, I couldn't give here without having an idea. But it gave me the skill of Jugaad, where I would go back, read a lot about it. I did some courses on construction, you know, within a short period of 2 months, and I could grasp everything. Here, at the same time, the CA skills, which I had learned of standard costing and marginal costing, so they came so handy with me that I could analyze the cost of construction the way I had done in CA. So that kind of overlapping helped me throughout my journey. Mm-hmm. A few other examples could be while I was doing my land acquisition stream. So land acquisition is a lot about negotiations and all. So that is when the MBA skill helped me. But there was this one particular instance where we were trying to convince the landowner for the structure which we had. So Godrej Properties has a different structure for land acquisitions from the typical market. We have been dealing with this landowner for quite some time and trying to explain him things. But somehow he was not getting convinced. But when I brought in my CA skill set and told him how this structure might benefit him in terms of his capital gains or his income tax structure, I think that is when he understood what our structure was, and that kind of helped me in that deal. So it has been that throughout the journey in different roles, it has always come hand in hand. And today, as I lead the business, so here I'm handling a team which a lot of my team members have 20 years of plus work experience. So when I'm dealing with them, the leadership skills or the people management skills that I learned in MBA, so that is where I'm able to relate both the skills together.
Okay. Thank you so much, Radhika, for that. We also have Shreya with us. While Radhika and Rahul have been freshly out of CA and they immediately moved towards MBA, we've got Shreya who wanted to test the waters and know which role to have and where to go. And it's only when she became really headstrong that she moved to MBA. Shreya, a quick question to you is that you've already worked in IB. People, you know, want a lucrative position in investment banking after MBA. So why go ahead and do an MBA?
Yeah, so interesting question, Vinay. So I got into IB to actually, it was a very educated and a conscious decision for me to get into IB because, as I said, you know, it was the craze of the market and it still is. Like people really want to get into investment banking and, you know, make big bucks. But investment banking as an industry is a very huge industry to be in. And there are many, many verticals in that. So I got into investment banking. I had a good role. So we were a support team in the investment banking domain to the London directors. So basically, the CEO of the bank, we were in actually his team. So it was a support function in the end. So whatever work I used to do, indirectly, it had a good impact. But I could see that, you know, directly, I'm not making any tangible impact. Rather than, you know, I wanted to become a decision maker. I wanted to contribute in tangible outcomes. And also, I had been talking during my stint with Deutsche Bank. I had been talking to like many people as to how had their MBA journey been and, you know, what motivated them to do MBA. I spoke to a lot of directors also of Deutsche Bank, looking at their profile. So that motivated me that, you know, if I want a profile change or a front-end position in investment banking domain, maybe MBA can prove to me as a ladder that I can climb. And, you know, if I want to be in the investment banking domain, it can give me a frontline position. And MBA, rather, you know, not looking only from this angle, it gives you a lot of other perks. It, you know, it, as Radhika said, you know, it gives you a skill of jugaad. It, you know, it modifies your personality. It makes you, you know, it makes you talk to random people with such confidence and content that you can really speak up and, you know, make your way out, make your things like quite in your preference. So I'm still in my second year, but the journey has been amazing and I'm really looking up to. So yeah, this made me, you know, leave investment banking and join MBA. But let's see what my, you know, way forward is.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that. With that, we'd like to ask Radhika. So, you know, Shreya shared her perspective about motivations to do MBA. Would you like to share yours?
So, apart from the fact that my mom wanted me to study further, the other motivation for MBA was when I was doing my articleship, I did a lot of internal audits. So when I was seeing these, basically I felt this was more of like a post-mortem analysis of the decisions taken by the management. And that is when I realized that rather than doing a post-mortem thing, I wanted to be in the decision-making shoes and analyzing those things at that moment. So that was one of major factors. Other than that, obviously, MBA gives you a lot of exposure, which I felt was missing somehow. Because I was always active in a lot of extracurricular things as well as the curriculum. But the exposure was somehow missing, which I thought MBA got it. And obviously the alum network, which you developed there, that is obviously a bonus when you do an MBA.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
That has been about
okay.
It.
Okay. When you mention alum network, it brings me out to ask Rahul Latta. You know, you've been from a brand. I am Ahmedabad. Pretty prestigious. I've you know, done my MBA from Institute of Management in my university. And every time I used to say I've done MBA from Ahmedabad, the first quick question would pop up saying, I am Ahmedabad. And I would disappointedly say, no, you know, it's the other campus. It works well and it has worked well for me. But then, yeah. So whenever we pass the campus, we would always wish, I wish. So Rahul, how do you leverage alum network at IMA?
This is one of the most important advantage of having a full-time journey in IIM Ahmedabad. There's an army of alum, and since the institute is here in existence for decades now, there are so many people who are very influential. So I would categorize to leverage the alum network in two broad parts. One is related to your business and your career. So apart from the routine job postings and, you know, references and industry insights, and if you have your own startups, you can actually connect with industry veterans and understand their perspective. Their guidance and mentorship could also help a lot. There is a social aspect to it as well. When we, you know, enter into a new city, then it is very difficult to get in touch with people whom you can click, right? And here in most cities, we have an alum group, which gives a ready reckoner to the people whom you can reach out to and who think alike. Also, there are accommodation threats and others. And in times like this, for example, pandemic, a guy in our campus has developed an app which would help people identify donors and would also track people who can give plasma. So those are the ways in which you can actually socially also collaborate with those people. And that is with you throughout your life. So that is how you basically leverage the army
alumni
of,
network.
Yes.
A quick follow-up question on that. Would you recommend having a WorkX plus MBA or a Fresher plus MBA?
So I would recommend having a WorkX. Although having said that, there are like 50% of the people in the batch that do not have any WorkX and they are straight out of college. But having WorkX would not only improve your or increase your chance to land up with the college because they have certain marks, brownie points awarded. When you have WorkX in the range of 0 to say 6 months to 18 months, and it keeps on increasing in every 6 months till we reach year three. After year three, the marks started getting decreasing. So they basically want to, after 3 years, they would want to motivate people to do executive MBA. And before that, actually, they award you marks. So that will help you to get into the MBA college. Plus, most of the MBA colleges have two kinds of placement seasons. So for us, we had two placement seasons. One was laterals and one was final. And to be eligible for the lateral placements, wherein you would have companies who are paying bigger pay scale and higher corporate ladder, higher designation. And to be eligible for that, you need to have a minimum set work experience, which is decided every year in college. So in during my time, it was about 18 months. And if you do not have that work experience, you do not qualify for that lateral. So that is why I also consider having lateral placement will help you ace out other candidates and will help to increase the opportunities for you. Also, having a brand name on your CV would definitely add some brownie points during
Thank
the lateral and final placement.
Thank you. That gives us a bit of clarity on how you know people are placed after they complete their MBA and why it matters to be a part of IIM Ahmedabad Alumni Network. Shreya, my question to you. Diverse options for the CA plus MBA. Could you throw some light?
Yeah, sure. So I just completed my autumn internship. So I know, like, you know, I have a background as to what kind of roles are really offered now for a CA plus MBA. So broad categories can be, so first is investment banking. Okay, IB, private equity, venture capitalist, funds, you know, startups are also in these cater, but yeah, mainly core finance. Then comes equity research roles. Like, you know, many CAs don't get an opportunity in equity research, but you get an opportunity after the blend of CA plus MBA. So these are two types of like more core finance roles. Then comes consulting, which is open to all domain, not only for finance or CA finance, but other domain specialization, people like marketing, everyone they apply. So consulting is one. So if you are very inclined into management consulting or strategy consulting, so, you know, that is one domain. Then fourth comes corporate finance. Corporate finance is a role where there's a company and unka corporate finance department. You work for the company, you manage the funds of the company. There are also treasury roles of banks that come in for CA plus MBA roles. Because they really look after this blend, okay? So that really works out for them. And the last option I feel, you know, option or a preference that CA plus MBA get is a general management role, which I think CAs miss out on this role because many companies prefer MBAs. Because, you know, if you have like companies like HUL, Pidilite, or, you know, TAS coming in, they really prefer MBAs. So they have their MBA program only. So, you know, CAs, normally only CAs, they can't get into these programs because they need an MBA tag also for that. So this is something that after MBA, they can get into these roles. So these are basically 5 to 6 fields that get open for CA post MBA, which is not easily available for a CA. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much. Radhika, I'd like to ask you about more about your current profile, if you could help us understand what value you're creating for Godrej.
So as I mentioned, my current profile is handling the P&L for approximately like 1,000 apartments to 2 projects in Bangalore. So when I say handling the P&L, it includes everything. Starting on the revenue side, you have sales, collections, and on the cost side, you have the cost of construction and all the other costs. And you are responsible to ensure that the bottom line as well as the MCFs is maintained. Because I've handled diverse profiles, I would say in land acquisitions, we were creating the business plan on Excel. You just see a piece of land and you make some business sense out of it and create a whole business plan out of it. And in the current profile, I am putting life to that business plan and probably ensuring that those returns which were projected come to life. So that has been okay. The current profile.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. So when she speaks more about, you know, top line and bottom line and how you ensure efficiency in processes, I'd like to ask Rahul Ladda about how he managed to, you know, create processes around receivables and help his company achieve probably a gain of a crore in 16 crores and or, yeah. So Rahul, I think it'll be better if you could just throw some light on it.
So basically we have two stints of 6 months each, and my first stint was with the corporate office, wherein I was working with a group CFO, and the task was to model to introduce a new concept to the group regarding the economic value addition. So we wanted to separate the way in which we currently look to the performance of the company, and I wanted to add a point that even if you are profitable, you might not be adding value to the corporate office. And for that, I had actually applied all the concepts that I have learned in CA and created a model which would help companies and corporate office both to look for the potential source of value creation by applying that model to the granular details of the company. So the company can apply the model at the company level and then can drill it down to the division level and then department level and see, hey, where manpower expense, this is actually eating up my economic value additions. So let me do something regarding this. Or fixed assets, these are actually reducing, pulling my valuation down. So let me work more and increase this valuation. So that was the task. For the first project, and it got very well accepted by the chairman and all the CEOs of the companies. The second project was in NBC, which is in Jaipur. So the task was to reduce the working capital requirements of the company and to identify opportunities to minimize the cost or to reduce the cost. So working capital, CA knowledge held that there are like three things in working capital and receivables. If we reduce the number of days of the receivables, we will be freeing up the working capital, which will help in saving interest. So I identify that there are certain receivables in our company which are from exports, and there was this motivation to reduce the working receivables days, for which we talked to the banks outside India for discounting it and had automated the process so that all the documentations which are required by the bank will straight away go to the bank and the process and the bank will process the payment. And this release of payment would only take 4 days instead of 25-30 days that it was taking earlier. And with that, we were able to free up 20 days in around 200 crores portfolio of receivables, which freed up actually 16 crores of working capital and saved around 1 crore of cost associated with it. So that was also a huge success. And that is because post that I was absorbed by this company.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. It was really insightful. And I'd like to ask Radhika about, you know, you've done your internship, you've done your articleship. How different is it to, you know, go ahead and do an articleship versus intern for a company? You could also share more about how you landed into a PPO and what could people do to ensure that their job is safe in this pandemic situation if we have any MBAs on the list.
So, Vinay, I would say articleship is immediately, you are like just probably 12th pass out or first year, because I did my articleship after IPCC. So that was just like 1 year of graduation completion. So that time I think you're more into, okay, I'm allowed to make mistakes, but I should learn more. So you're in that phase, and gradually increases because you have 3 years of time. So the learning gradually increases. Everything increases gradually. The dependency increases. Vis-a-vis internship, I would say it's just a 2 months thing. It's 2 months for you to identify if the company suits you, if the culture suits you, if the work suits you, and for the company to identify if you are the right fit for the company. So I would say that if anybody is doing currently their internship, if they see that this is the right fit, then they should obviously try for a PPO. And the easiest way I would say to get a PPO is to put in your best effort to the project which you're doing. Talk a lot to the people inside the company as well as to people in other companies in the similar domain, because that kind of opens you up to a lot of knowledge what's happening. There is a high chance that what you're doing is something which others might have done, or there is a chance that you might improve upon something which is already being done in the company. So I think that is the best way to get a PPO. And if you're in the current situation, I would say, given the current situation, the placement scenario doesn't look that bright. I'm sure Shreya can add more to it. So it is the best thing is to try and take your internship and convert it into a PPO.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much for that. So apart from campus placements, are you guys also aware of any consultancies, or you know, if anyone post MBA here is looking for a job, the best way that they can switch and get into any role that they should, or decide what kind of role they should be getting into? Two things. So Rahul or Radhika, would you like to throw some light on it? I'll repeat the question for you. So for example, you want to switch your job, Rahul, from CK Birla Group. We know you don't want to, but then in case you want to, what would be the places where you would be looking at? Don't tell me IMA jobs, because IM jobs, right? Apart from that, is there any place that you could be looking at, or how could you really identify what kind of work do you really want to do?
So the 1 year that I was an executive assistant made me identify the things that I really like. So there are certain things that I really like, but I do not have exposure to, wherein I definitely would want to go. So, and give it a shot. So the first thing, that is a current profile that I'm having, I was always inclined towards it, which is financial investment planning. I want to gain more experience as of now in this company, and then would try to switch in similar roles in other companies. And there's this another supply chain management role also that is on my cards as of now. I kind of find very interesting when I did a project around it. So given a chance, which might now be difficult, because considering that I already have 2 years of work ex in a general management role, will be difficult to switch for supply chain management. But if that happens in my company itself to relocate me to there in the another division, then I'll probably see where I should go. But I'm now pretty sure that I want to further my career in financial investment planning. So yeah, those were the roles that I'll look for, and the companies that would provide those roles.
Okay. So when you say that, you know, I'm inclined towards financial investment roles and I'd really like to go forward, what was that event or moment that helped you realize that I wish to head in this direction?
So while I was doing the projects, I actually wanted to know how those projects got sponsored. Mm-hmm. And the entire thing is there are like so many funds which are blocked in this project. So who's doing those investments, and who is doing those planning that we should invest here? We have recently acquired a firm. And that was the point wherein I got intrigued with this, that I want to make that decision, that which firm I want to acquire and why, what are the synergies, what is the valuation for that company. And mm-hmm. those were the points wherein I thought that this particular team has a lot of power. Plus, they have this future vision for the company, which you kind of built in right from the beginning. So those were the time where I felt, yes, this is the place for me.
Okay. Thank you. Radhika, was there any similar moment for you when you evolved between these three roles in Godrej? or did they just happen to, you know, flow with it?
So while the roles actually happen, but I would say that it has been great because every new role that you do, it's a different learning for you, which makes you realize what you're really liking at. So probably I'm still in that journey exploring roles and understanding, while I know that I always wanted to be in a business role. So all of these are sort of leading me closer to that, I would say. But yeah, I would say every role is different, and the learning curve which you have in a new role is way higher than what has been.
Okay. So it totally depends on your caliber and the work that you've been doing, which has helped you, you know, move on and feel that your ambit of responsibilities has increased over time. So when you say that, you know, you're probably helping the company on two grounds. One is helping them lower the bottom line and also up the NCA for the top line in any way. So coming from a CA background, right, you're dealing with projects which are into residential zones and areas. How do you manage to keep up with probably say construction guys, engineers, and also stay at pace with them so that you can have a meaningful conversation with them and also drive value, which you can use and probably portray in your P&L. Could you help us with that?
Oh, yeah, that's quite an interesting question. And it was an interesting challenge for me when I started this role, actually, because as I told people with whom I'm working, so for example, the salespeople are expert in sales. The construction guys have a lot of project experience. So I think what value I bring to it is because I have a strong financial background, something which I can show them is what impact are they having. So for example, if I'm able to give this insight to a construction guy, that one day delay in a slab cycle, what does that mean in terms of receivables? That one day delay is how much collection delay, and what value does that add? So that is where I think I'm able to probably add value to the company. As well as that brings me on a platform where I can discuss things with them, and it brings out probably people management skills in me, which MBA had given me.
Okay. So you said there are two major criteria. One is CA gives you those technical skills, which you can up your game and probably, you know, it helps you all across because now you have sound technical foundation. And two, management gives you a perspective into, you know, managing people, managing areas. So that's really helpful to know.
I would say CA is probably... So I would like to add here, Vinay. CA is like probably it gives you the material, the substance, and MBA is that wrapping paper around. So it helps you to portray things.
Okay. All right. So we have a couple of questions also coming up in the chat box. Probably Shreya's into you know, her second year, and she could help us understand if Kaustubh Jhawar should do a part-time MBA or full-time MBA. What are your thoughts on it, Shreya?
All right. So hi, Kaustubh. So if you are planning to do MBA, I think one should see MBA. Don't look at MBA from a CV perspective. Okay. So MBA should be an all-rounder learning, personality development experience for you. So part-time MBA, I don't know if that will solve the purpose, because for example, the full-time MBA, you have 2 years, you live in the campus, mainly MBA is also for networking and making contacts and, you know, talking to so many people who come from different walks of life with varied perspectives towards life. So, you know, it kind of gives you a very out-of-box thinking, which we, as, you know, prior MBA, we somewhere miss out because we just think in one direction sometimes. So this full-time MBA, the campus experience, the, you know, all this experience will add on to your journey, and it also forms a very critical part to your experience. And these are the experiences that you will, you know, that will nurture your personality going ahead. Because, you know, CA gives you all the knowledge. MBA helps you sell it. Okay, so in order to sell your knowledge, in order to sell yourself, you need to be a very well-groomed person, and that a full-time MBA actually makes you, you know, it grills you and makes you that kind of a person whose demand in the market is very huge, and you can capitalize and leverage on that personality. So I think definitely a full-time MBA, but a part-time MBA, if you are, you know, crunched with time and other things, a part-time MBA will also suffice. But look out for, you know, there are executive MBAs or some, you know, good campuses where you will have a very good journey and you will have really good network and contacts. I think that will also serve your purpose. So it depends on your purpose. I think you can make a clear choice.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much for that. There's Deepak Singh Thakur who asks, is LLB the best option after MBA? Probably, Radhika, could you throw some light on, is it about, you know, legal options that one could opt for after MBA? Is there any legal profile?
Similar to that. Mm-hmm. So I would say CFA versus MBA.
Okay.
So I would say after CA, a lot of options do open up. So if you are very sure that you want to do a practice or something, then probably you can just specialize in some area and do it. But if you are sure that you love the legal angle of it and you want to develop yourselves into that, because a lot of today, IDT has a lot of litigations. DT also has a lot of litigations. So in that case, if you're inclined towards that, then probably CA plus LLB could be a great option. And you could choose your area of specialization to one of the tax laws. For CFA, I would say similarly, it is that if you're very inclined towards portfolio management, research and investment, so then CFA could be a good option. So all these courses are very specific that when you are interested in them, then you could choose one of those options, CA, CFA, CS, CWA, FRM, actuaries. But if you are not inclined to one specific option and want to explore your options, then I would say that and want to gain more exposure and understand your options, then I would say MBA would be a great idea.
All right. Thank you so much. Gopal, I would request you to stay patient with us. Ashutosh asks, and my question is directed towards Rahul, did you find any challenge or advantage during the MBA course in comparison to engineers?
Yes, definitely. Like, right from the entry, you get an advantage that you are from a diverse background, because of late there have been cases wherein they are actually giving you the brownie points if you are not an engineer. So right from the entry to the course itself, the first year, there are a lot of finance courses which you can resonate to the concept that you have learned in CA. It's exact same. And you will excel it. So CA people in campus for the first year have altogether different swag. And there are actually those engineers from IIT Delhi or Bombay who would come down to you and ask questions. Yaar, kal exam hai, aaj padha de mere ko. So you will have a lot of advantage. Even after the first year, while you are summer internships and, you know, in the final placements as well, there are companies that actually will shortlist you. Just because you're a CA. So all the investment banks and, you know, private equity and VCs will definitely shortlist you. Mostly they do, because they want that kind of crowd in their company, CA plus MBA wala.
Okay. All right. You seem pretty biased towards engineers. You're stealing away all opportunities, but then nonetheless, the engineer in me feels bad, but then what makes sense is colleges do prefer.
Actually, in our case, we do not have that network before going into the college, right? So we do not know what happens after that. But for engineers, they have that network. Their seniors or juniors somewhere from somebody from their batch is there in the campus. And because this knowledge passes on, engineers to compete with CAs and get up those investment banking and private equity jobs, they start doing CFA. To show their interest to the companies that they are also inclined towards finance. And that is how you compete with them. Because those guys have CFA level 2 or level 3 cleared. And that is also an inclination towards finance to portray at least. And you also have a strong financial degree. So you compete with those guys actually.
All right. Thank you so much for that. Shreya, the question for you, since you're, you know, latest, how did you prepare for your entrance? And also somebody asked up there, did you study in parallel? But then yes, you've got that chunk of 2.5 years post your CA. So if somebody is, you know, pursuing CA, should he probably study along with it, or he should complete his CA, finish it up, group one, group two, clear all subjects, get those group marks, and then move towards preparing for CAT? your take on it?
Yeah, it seems, Vina, you have a good knowledge about CA, you know, you know most of the stuff. So if you are targeting to complete, you know, you want to become a CA and then MBA, so I think that should be a step-by-step journey. Please complete your CA first. Otherwise, you know, there is a possibility that you become, you know, jack of all, master of none. So it's better that you have complete your CA. Because you need to justify what you do, okay? So CA, once completed, and as Rahul mentioned earlier, that, you know, WorkEx is important in order to get into a good institute. But from my angle, is like, it also gives you a lot of clarity. So if you already know that you want to do MBA somewhere down the line, and you are working also, so I advise that, you know, you can start your CAT ka preparation with your WorkEx. Because I'll tell you what happens. Not all, but, you know, some 50-60% of CAs, I can speak for them. Like, you know, our maths is, you know, gets stops after 12th standard. So, you know, during CA and during after CA, the maths portion, we get a bit weaker on that portion. So it's better you get, you know, during your work, if you start preparing for CAT, it is better because you can keep practicing and you can get a good score. So if you're very inclined ki MBA karna hai, so you can start your preparation with your WorkEx. Okay. So yes, that will be the major calling.
All right. Thank you so much. We've got a couple of other questions as well. So there's this guy, so he's into engineering. If anybody would like to answer, or I could answer it myself. I'm a recent graduate in ENTC engineering, but don't want to pursue technical further. Should I look up for a non-tech job or get MBA immediately? If either of you, would you like to throw some light on it, on technical or non-technical stuff? You could probably look at it from a CA perspective if you would like to go ahead. So yeah, Rahul, do you have anything for him, or I could go on, Rahul?
Yeah, so it is very difficult because it is very subjective. Give an advice, I would say you do not want to do that job of that technical nature, then, and want to switch and try out different things, then an MBA can be a good option.
Okay, makes sense. All right. Here's my piece of advice on it. So I got done with my engineering in 2013, and I was completely aware of the fact that coding skills are not my cup of tea. I had that degree for the sake of an engineer because it helps you graduate, and you can only postgraduate after you graduate, right? But then there's something that I clearly understood, that I cannot take a tech job. So, and my father suggested that once you start earning, probably you wouldn't, you know, want have time or know when to go ahead and do an MBA. So if there's a calling which says that, you know, you have the capability, the finances, and an opportunity to go ahead and do an MBA, just go ahead and do an MBA. If you're looking for a non-tech job in this COVID pandemic situation, and if you don't have one, I'd like to pray how you find one. So try and see if what's the calling, what are the finances managed, and just don't go and do an MBA simply because you have time and you have nothing else to do. Okay, add it as a tool, right? And don't waste money on an MBA degree if you're just going there for the sake of it. MBA should be a very conscious decision. So till graduation, you can do whatever you'd like, but then MBA should be a conscious decision. CFA versus MBA, I guess we've discussed that, right? Okay, as this year is challenging, should 2020 be valuable for doing MBA? Anybody's take on that? Shreya?
Yeah.
So really hit the gun point down, because I'm experiencing this. it is a difficult year to be in. To be frank, I'm in my second year, and I missed out, on my rural internship, on my 1 year US experience. So there is a lot of missing out, to be frank. But at the same time, the institute takes really good care of you. Okay, so whichever institute you are in, the placement process takes care of you. And also, to be frank, regardless of the placement process, even if you go in the market, it's quite challenging and competitive. Okay, even pre-COVID scenarios, I think it has been competitive. So I feel one person should really, you know, even in the placement season of MBA, I feel you really need to be very headstrong first as to where do you want to get in. For example, if you want to get into investment banking or a genman role, be very headstrong, do your research, do your homework, and, you know, have a very good, clear understanding about your background, about what the company does, and prove your mettle accordingly. So I think once you are very much prepared as to how you want to see your future and how, where you want to be, I think the probability of you converting any company for that matter increases way beyond. So I think that clarity of mind as to where you want to fall into is very important. And once that is sorted, just the preparation part, I think it gets taken care of on its own. So I think the clarity is the main part here.
Right. So clarity will give you that fuel burning in your stomach, which will help you go ahead and deal with CAT, because CAT in itself is a pretty challenging exam, as you know, we discussed earlier. Yeah. And okay, this one question. Okay. So this Gopal has asked a question. Okay. And it involves both engineering and finance. So hence I like to redirect it towards you all. It says, BTech mechanical engineering plus lectureship and diploma plus MBA. Can it change my phase to career in finance? So let me know if you want me to repeat that question, or Radhika could take it up because I can see that she wants to answer.
Sure, sure. I can take this up. I think Rahul mentioned about this. So a lot of engineers are post-MBA take up finance roles. And so obviously, if you are like, if you're interested in finance, you can definitely take up, you can definitely, the MBA can definitely help you that. But it doesn't mean that only, you have to show your inclination also towards it. So for example, a lot of engineers do CFA or some other course in finance where they're inclined while doing their MBA and specializing in finance. So if you're good in finance and if you show your inclination, I think definitely post-MBA, you can make that switch.
Okay.
Does that All answer right. it?
I think it will, or probably, you know, we can assume it did. So if anybody has any other thoughts on it, Shriya, Rahul, they can jump in and add. Do you have any other thoughts? Are you good?
I think I resonate with what
Yeah, same.
Okay, wonderful. That's the best way out. So yeah, three people resonate and I agree. Okay. Yes. So if anyone's doing business, right? So they've got their family business. Should they go ahead and do an MBA in business, or should they just probably think, continue with their business and move ahead and probably somewhere down the line, if at all? So could you help us with that?
Yeah, actually, I'll just take up that question, because see, there are many institutes, for example, where I'm doing MBA from, for example, SPGN Institute of Management and Research. So it has an FMB program. So that's a family managed business program. So, you know, it is a blend for MBA of MBA for the business candidates. So it helps you expand your horizon into your own business. So, you know, there are many such programs that are coming up with reputed institutes. So I think one needs to be really informed as to which institute is offering what, because there are no more only PGDM or, you know, executive MBA. There are many such courses also coming up. So if you are a very headstrong that, you know, you want to be in business only, so I think you all can reach out to these institutes and see what works best for you. It's a very good thing that's coming up now.
All right. Thank you. So it's not just about choosing colleges. It's also the variety of programs, the structure in which they've laid it out, the faculty or the academics and the future placements, you know, the opportunities that one can get into. Thank you so much for that. I guess we've exhausted our bit of question rounds. There's just this one because I think we picked it up. Yeah. Somebody saying something? Okay. One says, how can one look for off-campus job opportunities? So is there anyone, Shriya, or probably Radhika? Shriya, well, basically because you're in that phase and if you're...
Okay, off-campus. So after, see, there are two parts to it. So if you do your MBA and then you want to search out of campus, I think, you know, as they mentioned, you know, Rahul and Radhika mentioned earlier, I think the alum base is something you can really massively leverage on, because you know once you do MBA you get into contact with many people, and it's mm-hmm. as I said, you know, it's a journey. So it's not only your journey, it's, you know, you're living the journey with many people in the institute, so you know who is where and you can leverage that contact. And also, you know, these portals like LinkedIn and, you know, IIM Jobs, I think they're very well versed with, you know, they actually understand your personality, your CV and your fit as well. So you can find out jobs, but I think the majority portion will be taken care of by the alum. Alum strength, no one can beat the alum strength. So okay. That part, yes.
Thank you. Radhika, my question to you, 4 years down practice and now looking for corporates, is it advisable to prepare for CAT or look for jobs in the market?
That's, I think, a trick question, because I think Rahul also answered a bit of it. 4 years if you have work X. So then it becomes, most of the institutes don't take it very positively. I would suggest if you're still looking for an MBA, then maybe an executive MBA would be a better option than doing a formal 2 years course. And if looking for going to market in the sense like switching a job or something, if you're comfortable in the same profile, if you're looking that I want to do audit or taxation or the kind of roles which are available to CA, in spite of having 4 years of practice, if you want to switch to corporate, I don't think so that's a challenge. You can switch as it is. But in case you want to change the profile itself, then I would suggest an executive MBA would be a good option.
Okay. Rahul, my question for you. Palash is in the second year of his articleship and planning for industrial training, further inclined towards MBA. What could be the best possible path for him? That's the latest question on the chat.
Second year of articleship. He's into second year of articleship and is planning for industrial training. So, possible path. I couldn't understand the question. What could be the best possible path?
Okay.
You're saying either you want to continue the articleship or you want to do the industrial training. Which one will help you to get into
yes.
MBA? Is that the question?
Yes. I think that's. And he says yes.
Yeah,
as well.
I think industrial. Yes. Okay. So I think industrial training would help you, and that will be counted as a good work ex because you already have 2 years of articleship, and another perspective is industrial training. I think that will be better.
Okay. Deepak Singh, this question is directed towards Radhika. Deepak saying he did his MBA in finance, so can he practice as a tax consultant? Please suggest.
While you've done, typically the taxation part, which MBA covers most of the colleges, is at the surface level. Amount of knowledge which we have in taxation during our CA curriculum is way deeper. But having said that, if you have an expertise in that matter, so then obviously there's no one who can stop you from doing a tax consultancy, but if provided you have an expertise, and MBA in finance is definitely not assuring you to be a tax consultant.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Also something that came up in our past discussion is that post CA, you can either get into audit role or tax role. Audit role is more generalized, but then tax role, if you get into tax as such per se, you are into say 2-3 years of doing tax, it gets labeled to you and then you move in that direction. So if that helps in any way to understand, right? Padipa. Yes, she is smiling, right? So yeah, a bit of knowledge interacting with CAs. With that, I guess we've covered a majority of the questions. Do you have any concluding remarks? Radhika, followed by Rahul and then Shriya. Before we close this webinar, I hand it over to Mahendra ji for vote of thanks. Yes, Radhika.
The concluding remarks would be that, as we discussed, that if you really want to do an MBA after CA, then you should go for an MBA. And if you're looking to explore more and understand what is there out there and probably gain more exposure, then MBA is for you. But if you're very sure this is what I want to do, then we would recommend that. You go in that part directly. So probably that.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Rahul.
So I would say yes, whatever Radhika said, actually I totally resonate with that. And one more thing, to prepare CAT, just a small tip from my side, you should do a lot of mock tests, which will help you in identifying where you are getting things wrong. Is that the time management? Is that the kind of questions, particularly wherein you are taking a lot of time? So you can always get into that feedback loop again and again and improve on that. So that is the way to, you know, prepare for CAT. As far as I am concerned, I did like CAT. And yes, if you know that you want to build your career in a particular direction, do not wait for an MBA. No degree can help you with that. You have to go, you can go directly. And if you're still looking out for options, then it might help. Yes.
Okay. Shreya, before you, you know, begin with your concluding remarks, there's just this one question which is, you know, popping its head up again and again. Can you please also answer MBA in India or MBA abroad? So if you could answer that and then share your.
Okay. I can give you examples. See, so a couple of my friends are giving GMAT after 4 years of experience, work experience. Okay, now. So I had asked them that why not CAT? So they had said that, you know, they want to explore, you know, MBA is something, you know, it changes you very inside out. It is a very good journey that you can be in. So actually it depends on what you want. So for example, the friend of mine wanted to do out because he wanted to do in the Ivy League. He wanted to meet people from different cultures and, you know, had that kind of experience and also settle abroad. Okay, because once you do MBA abroad, there's a high chance that, you know, you will be settling abroad only because the kind of ROI also we are looking at and, you know, because the fees is also higher and then you want to repay and everything. So if your inclination is there, you can do MBA abroad. But also having said that, abroad MBA needs you to take at least 4 to 5 years of work experience. Okay, post that you can get into a good MBA institute outside, like, you know, the Ivy Leagues or even the second tier of Ivy League. So you need to get good work experience and then choose wisely. Otherwise, so that is your decision-making point. So if you have good work experience and you want to settle out and, you know, want to have a global experience, you can take MBA abroad. And if you have an inclination that you want to settle into, you know, settle in India only, you can have MBA here. But that doesn't restrict you to that, you know, that you cannot settle outside after doing MBA in India. So you have many options, but basically look out for these parameters that, you know, firstly is global tagline, want to settle abroad, and also look at your ROI as to how you want to, you know, see ahead. So that is three major points. You need to decide whether you want to do here or outside.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Have one thing to add to this question.
Please, Rahul.
So while what she said is correct, but in cases like in our college and in her college as well, SP Jain, they plan in such a way that they give an opportunity to pursue an MBA from the abroad, from the college outside India as well. So you get a dual degree. So that is also available in most colleges. So if you want to have a dual degree also, then you just spend like 6 months outside India and you get that degree and you get the degree in India as well.
Wonderful.
I don't know.
All right. Yeah. Okay. I would now like to request Mahendra ji to please take over and share his vote of thanks. I'd also like to acknowledge Manav ji's presence. He joined us at 5:15. Yes, Mahendra ji, over to you.
So good afternoon, everyone. I will like to start with first thanking Sri Atulji Lahuti, who as president of MBBM has created this platform and under whose leadership we are now seeing the very high frequency of the webinars. And I would like to thank Sri Brajendra Maluji, under whose initiative now we have this series of webinar where for the first time our scholars are conducting the entire series of webinars. And he has been instrumental in getting these people along. I would also like to acknowledge the contribution and the backbone support by Manak Chandji Kabra. I would especially like to thank Sri G.D. Mundraji. G.D. Mundraji is a veteran of the field. He has been in executive and I mean CEO role in different corporations, and he's very well versed with the struggle between CA and MBA and other disciplines. And he has kindly agreed to coordinate the session for us today. So thank you very much, Sri G.D. Mundraji. My special thanks to Vinay, because I think this series of webinar would have been nothing but for Vinay, the way he coordinates everything, the way he conducts the whole sessions. I think he makes sure that every moment of the webinar is lively and interesting. I would also like to thank our panelist for today. Today we had a potpourri of the panelists. We have three very, very brilliant and intelligent panelists. So we have Radhika, who did his MBA after CA. We have Rahul, who while he was doing CA, he knew that he wants to do MBA and CA is not where he wants to really end. And then we have Shreya, which has done CA, then she worked and now she is doing MBA. So you can see the whole range of possibilities and what kind of emotions one young person goes through while it is still in the academic sector and what kind of possibilities open. So I think between the three of them, they gave us a flavor of how to choose your career at different stages of your academics. How can you make the right choice with experience, with your inner feelings, and learning from your space where you are interacting with other people. So I think that's very interesting viewpoint for me. And then we discussed a whole range of issues. I think if you look at someone like Radhika, and you can see the sense of ownership when she talks about managing a profit center. I think that's something which is a takeaway for me from this session. And I think if you look at her success, her sense of belonging, her sense of ownership to her job, I think makes a difference. That clearly touched my heart. And then if you look at Rahul, I think that's an example of how you decide that, this is not something I want to do, and then what is the right choice for me to do. And then, while doing CA and then suddenly getting into an IIMA is great. So I think that's a brilliant achievement. Congratulations, Rahul. And then you look at Shreya. I think this is a new generation of people who know what they want to do. And they know what they want to do, not because somebody tells them or it just one fine morning occurs to them. They learn it the hard way, grinding. And then they know, look, this is what I want to do. I think that is a big motivation for all the young guys who are on this webinar to understand how to make the right choice in life. And I was particularly impressed by how she responded to a very pertinent question, do MBA in India or do MBA abroad? I think the way she dissected the whole situation, I think that's a very, very clear decision point for every student who is trying to aspire for the foreign MBA, but then he knows that there is enough value within India. And we have the same debate at my house, and that's therefore I can relate to that point. And then I think she very, very correctly pointed out to the ROI aspect. And I think that is again the acumen that the people have. And the other thing which was very, very enlightening for me is that if you are a CA and an MBA, you always get a much better job profile. And then an MBA with a CA is also equally a preferred over an only MBA. So I think there is a lot of value proposition which the combination of these two courses bring. So I think I can go on this front. I think in short, I would like to thank these people because this has been such a nice link to our previous webinars where we first talked about the opportunities for CA in investment banking, opportunities for CAs in consulting, opportunities for CAs in industry. And today we have added a completely different dimension on how a combination of CA and MBA makes a big difference to what kind of job that you do. Clearly, the job that these two people are doing and what Shreya will get, I think they are clearly see your material. It's very clear from the webinar. So my best wishes for you, for your future, all three of you. And finally, I would like to thank Saloni Cabra. She is also one of our scholar awardee. She is again very brilliant. It is, I think, her initiative that we are having this series of webinars. She is obviously not on the screen today, but we can only appreciate the contribution she has made from the background. And again, like I said, without Vinay and Saloni, this series of webinars would not have been possible. I would finally like to compliment our technical team, Jess Jaju, and all the office staff in MVPM who have helped us put this whole thing together. So thank you so much once again, everyone, for all your contribution. And finally, last but not the least, without the audience, these webinars have no meaning. So I am very, very thankful to people who have, you know, spared their time on a Saturday evening to be with us. And once again, with my best wishes for the future success of our panelists today, I would like to say goodbye to all of you. You can all now please log out of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your kind words, Jajuji. Yes. I would like to thank, you know, the speakers for being with us all throughout and for bearing along. And I would really agree with what Jajuji has clearly, you know, understood and shared with us. And this webinar series has been really brilliant. And Jajuji, I would like to personally thank you for your constant support and encouragement. You've been the lubricant between the teams, between the technical support, between allowing us this opportunity and platform to make it happen, and also supporting us whenever the time be. So thank you so much, Jajuji. With that, I'd like to request all the participants and the speakers and esteemed guests to proceed with their evening. Thank you so much. It was nice connecting with you. Please take care. Stay safe. Yes, yes, Arati. सबसे अच्छे बच्चे कौन? लाउटी लाउटी. I'll stay here till the last person leaves. Thank you, audience, for being a part and tagging along.